Yeah, okay. Sonic says go, so I better do it. Hi, everybody. Thanks for your patience. I am Caitlin Glass. Jamie will hopefully be joining us, mainly because I really wanted to hear from him, because I only met him, like, yesterday. I'm like, wow, you've done a lot of stuff. I'm going to talk directing with you. So this is meant to be a directing panel. I do have a solo Ask Me Whatever the Heck You Want panel tomorrow, but who knows? I'll just briefly let you know my directing history, I suppose. I started directing very shortly after voice acting in 2005. I've directed things like, Case Closed, Suzuka, One Piece, some of Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, Ouran High School Host Club, Riddle Story of Devil, the three different Garo titles, Love Life Sunshine. Hey, he's here! I knew if I started, he would appear. Yay! Come on in.
How are you?
Grab a chair.
Yay!
Hey, we're just doing the intro thing, letting people know what we've directed.
One thing about this place that's just wonderful, that the air conditioning is definitely working.
Yeah?
It's freezing. Who's cold?
Do you need this sweater?
Especially you. I could use a run. I don't want to interrupt.
That's cool. I think I was almost done going down the list, just trying to remember things that I've directed. Primarily, actually only, for Funimation. All the titles I've directed are anime for that. So,
very cool.
That's me.
Yeah. So, my background is I'm a live action director. I started at Leo Burnett Advertising. I was a producer there. My first work was Oprah Winfrey Show. I was an intern in Chicago all through my college years, and then I got a job at Leo Burnett. And I was a producer there for 10 years. I was hiring guys like Michael Bay to direct for these commercials. Then started directing TV commercials, and then my rep for commercials started saying that, 14 years ago, you should really get into directing games, because I graduated from Second City in Chicago just to make me a better writer-director, not to do anything with acting. But then, she said, you really should look into game directing. I'm like, what, Centipede? I didn't know what she was, really talking about. She's like, no, these are big games, $40 million games, all this stuff. And I was like, I had no really idea what was going on at that time. And then a project came up, EverQuest 2, and that was a monster game. It was 110,000 lines of dialogue at the time, and that was my first game, but it was because I was such an experienced director already. I'm in the Directors Guild, and I've directed so many live action projects for years and tons of voiceover for commercials and stuff like that, but that's where I started. And after EverQuest 2, which at the time was the biggest game ever recorded, then went on to a lot of other projects. Right now I'm working on Crucible, and I directed Zelda Breath of the Wild, and one of the characters in it. How to get a voice acting? Cast yourself. But the client asked me, actually. They said, we want you to play Sidon. And so Breath of the Wild, and then Horizon Zero Dawn, and then Final Fantasy Mobius, which is the downloadable one, and then Final Fantasy 13, Final Fantasy 14, and Hitman Absolution, and then the new Hitman. So the last 8 years I've been directing Hitman, and I've got writing credits on both of those too. So I do a lot of that kind of stuff. And there's a bunch of other games, like Let It Die, Bulletstorm, a bunch of other games in between, but a bit of Halo, cast Halo 4 and 5, and so a bunch of that stuff. A lot of motion capture, and a couple feature films, Video X, the Dwayne and Darla Jean story. It's like a Bonnie and Clyde meets Blair Witch kind of thing. And co-wrote a feature out of China. It's about a 2-star film out of 10. They brought me in late, so it was so I produced on that too. So that's Back to the Sea, and then working with China on a couple other projects too. And some more motion capture stuff. So that's what I've been doing lately.
Impressive.
Wow. Equally.
So this is when we don't really have a moderator, so we could
just talk
to each other.
Kind of stuff do you guys, so everybody in here, is everybody interested in voice acting? Or is it just, who's interested in being a voice actor? A lot of people are interested in hearing about is it the games we're working on, or just feel free to
the
it's
casting
a small group.
Process or the process of recording actors, how it's different for anime versus video games?
Can you explain the casting process, like how it's
one, because I can speak about it from the anime side, and
absolutely.
You can talk about it for games.
Yeah.
So casting for anime, at least at Funimation, which is where I work, it's going to be different at the Los Angeles studios. Most of the time, historically, the Japanese clients have not been involved in the casting. occasionally, they want to be with bigger titles, but I could probably count those shows on maybe like one hand, maybe two hands only, and I've worked for Funimation for going on 15 years. So, but how it would work is there is a director. The director will also be, the casting director is also the one directing the actors, whereas in Los Angeles, there could be someone, and it's their job to cast the show, and that's it. And then another director's job to direct the actual actors in the process of the work. But at Funimation, the director does it all, which is awesome. And nowadays, because of what's called simuldubs, does anybody know what a simuldub is? Oh good, more people are learning what the heck that is. Essentially, that is an anime that is dubbed within a week or 2 weeks of it airing in Japan. You can watch it streaming here in English. So we work an episode at a time on like a broadcast schedule, cranking out. I think I put out 2 episodes a week because I work on 2 different shows. Because of that, we don't have a lot of time for auditions anymore. So what we'll do is draw off of old audition files that we have on file and talking to a lot of the other directors, listening to actors in other people's shows and just finding stuff on the network that Funimation has. Every once in a while, we get to have a big open audition, so no one's auditioning for a specific show. They're just coming in and showing, look at all of the stuff I can do. And one director's in charge of that, and then they'll pass around all of the folks that did a good job. Their names go out to the rest of us, and we can pull from them if we want. But usually, or the way it used to be, there's a show, and I find the characters that I need to hear actors read for. I make what are called sides. It's just got a couple pictures, maybe 4 or 5 lines of information about the character, and that's all, because we really don't have time for more than that. And 5 or 6 lines of dialogue that they have. And if you were an actor, you'd come in, you'd grab this book full of these sides, and there'd be some notes from the director, like, here's what the show's about. We'd let you know some information about it, like if it's maybe TVMA, if it has language or things like that. And then say, pick 2 or 3 characters and come on in. You'd come in the booth, you'd read them. I might give you some notes to see how well you take direction, and maybe what you thought the voice should be is not what I thought the voice should be, so let's see if I can get you to what I need or not. And after that, you're cast or you're not cast. And it's not like theater, where you'll find out if you're not. You know, we don't have time to call back the 200 people that came to read for this show. So you know you're in it when your agent calls you and you book time.
Yeah. Description about it all. Yeah. Games is, you know, it's in a similar vein. It depends on the size of the game. You know, when it's a big game, it's a $50, $100 million game, you know, you have to really, you put the casting out there. There's about 17 different agencies, being up to 20 different agencies sometimes that I work with. I'll have my ideas of people that I would like to bring in for casting, but there's a few different ways. There's like remote casting, where I will send out, sides, where there's a few different lines, a picture, a description, we'll send it out to like lots and lots of people, and because there might be 200 characters in a game, you know what I mean? So it could become ridiculous, and then maybe 10 or 15 lead, Captain, nice to see you. And there might be 10 or 15 lead characters that I can really focus on, and the peripheral characters aren't quite as important. So sometimes we'll do what they call remote casting. You send it out to the agents, talk to each one of them, get very specific on each character, and I pour over my sides to make sure everything is detailed so I don't get that call back from an agent going, what about this accent? And, you know, I'm very specific, even to the point where I send them links accents.
We love that.
Yeah. As actors, yeah. I try to be so specific because my background, too, is I didn't pursue acting, but I understand what they need very specifically. So the more information, the better, without going, you know, 6 pages. You know, you got to be specific, you know, very tight with some of the stuff, but give them a lot of information. So those are the rope casting, where they'll record at home or at their agency. Then they'll send me stuff, and then I'll have an inbox full of a lot of auditions. Like, there's times where big games where I've had, you know, 800 auditions or more. And, you know, it's just massive amounts. And that's like one part of the game. Another part, I might have another 300 auditions or 400 auditions. And it's just, and each person might be doing 2 roles or something. And so it can become pretty crazy. But that's for the big games like Halo. And, you know, Hitman, where you're just like, I'm going to flip over every single stone to find the right person. It's easy to catch. cast through Usual Suspects. Usual Suspects that you hear and give your game, you know, you hear, and they're geniuses, they're brilliant. But I like to find new people. Like the motion capture actor for Halo, I met in a tiki bar. You know, he just had this great manner, and I was like, okay, what's with the George Clooney thing? And he's just, he goes, oh, I'm good friends with George, and he had this kind of manner, and I was like, God, I think I found Master Chief. And sure enough, Master Chief, he became Master Chief. And we still had to go through the process of you know, casting, and I said, this is my guy, this is my guy. And same thing with Thorne, there was for Halo 5, and I had a guy that...
I'm like, that's my character from a different game. I'm like, what?
But he was just, you know, I just, it was a guy, Ike Amadi, and I just knew that he was the guy, and they went to New York, and went everywhere, we went right back to this guy. So there's sometimes I'll have somebody really in specifically in mind in these things. Then there's other times where you do live casting, and I don't want to repeat what we're saying as far as, you know, you won't, if the actor gets booked, the agent will call him, you know, or if it's non-union, I might call him, or the recording studio might call him, or something like that. But there's sometimes where a client will require live auditions. So you don't see as many people. You might see 40 people in a day, maybe 45 people in a day. They'll come in to a studio. It's much more specific, because then you can really dial in the character in the audition and say, okay, then when they leave, you've got it. With the big, big games, it's hard to do that for all the characters, because you might spend 4 weeks just auditioning. You know, you want to get to it, and there's budgets. You know, sometimes these games have huge, huge budgets, but there's line items. You know, you have to meet the budget. You have to meet the budget of this line item. You can't take too much time with this, can't take too much time for that. But the casting process is, you know, the most critical time, and each game is different. Each game is so different. You know, there might be just a quick turnaround or something where I'm able to give, like, new actors. I mean, I love giving people a fresh start. There's a girl that I met here, she's 17 years old, and she wants to be a voice actor. She's been hanging around with us, and, you know, in the Zelda booth, and just she wants to do it, and her parents and everybody's moved to LA. I said, well, here's our information, keep in contact. And I love doing that, finding new people. And for so many games, I brought new people in that had never been in anything before, but they had something. So I try to cultivate people, because I've worked with Troy and with Nolan and all the main guys for years and years and years. So, and they're genius, they're brilliant, but it's always great to bring more people in for those kind of things. So after the casting process, then you get the either call or you don't get the call, and you move on to the next one. You know what I mean?
Okay, so. For your work, do you usually have an assistant or anyone else to help you as a whole team? Because it sounds like
it's a lot.
You handle a lot.
It's a lot of stuff, and sometimes multiple games. But I you know, I was a producer for years, so I'm kind of, I could juggle it pretty well.
At Funimation, I don't. We, as a directing team, work together, not to cast each other's shows, but it's really tricky because we'll be working on the current season and trying to wrap it up with our two shows a piece. So that's all winding down, but we still have the same amount of work, and in the meantime, we've been given our assignments for the coming season. And we start researching, and some things have a manga, so there's an origin story that we can start. Who are these characters? What is this about? Some things are completely original, and all that a director knows or has seen is the Japanese PV, which is in Japanese and is usually just clips from the opening theme song sequence, right? So we go to this cast meeting where we're looking at all of the actors that we have, and we do use a lot of Usual Suspects because in ADR, it is a skill that not everybody can master, and now we have to work so quickly that bringing in new people, we all want to do it, but we kind of have to figure out when and where and how, right? So the nine of us, actually even more than that, because there's a night crew as well, so anywhere from 9 to 12 to 13 of us are sitting down looking at who we already have figured out. Like, I know these people are going to be my leads, and there's some glasses character, so, you know, maybe this guy who always is the glasses character. And we have producers that help us, an assistant producer who, she has this sheet planned out where she keeps track of every actor that's been cast with a number next to their name per season, so we know how many shows they're in. If they're in three shows, how many of those roles are lead roles versus supporting roles, because there are only so many hours in a day. It is also, we don't want to wear out the actor, but it's more like, what if that person is in four lead shows and all of them are night shift shows? Well, night shift, they only have 20 hours a week to get an episode done, whereas I have 35 hours to get two episodes. So it's like, it's this crazy Tetris thing going on. So we work as a team, but I don't have a personal assistant, no.
For me, it's just like I'm a freelancer.
I like one. I don't really need one. You know, I am collaborative, but I don't collaborate on my own cast with all of the other directors because we each have a different style, and some directors really love a particular actor and can get great performances out of them, and then others can't. They just don't click with them. They don't have a good rapport. I do have one of my best friends that I usually go to her and talk to her about what I'm thinking because she just has such a purity, like a pure anime fan's response to casting. And she's also an actress, and she can amazingly compartmentalize like what she wants as an actress and what she knows is going to sound great because she's a fan of all of these actors. So I'll be like, I'm thinking about doing this with these two characters, and if she makes a face, I'm like, okay, that's bad, all right. Most of the time she gets really excited about my ideas, so I like to have a sounding board, that's what I call her, but she's not like my assistant. Yeah.
For me, it's I don't have an assistant because it's 95% of the stuff I direct, I cast. But certain, like Bang Zoom, they do a lot of anime and a lot of ADR, a lot of dubbing there. So they have an internal person that casts there, so they cast all their shows there. But I have to be in the process because it would take me more time to describe what I need to an assistant than to actually do it myself. And when you're casting, boy, it is intense because you're just getting emails all day. You're at your computer at home. It's like, oh, you get to work at home. It's like, this Twitch didn't help at all. You know, you just try, you know, it's so much responsibility in these projects, you know, it's like these big games, and they give you so much trust when all of a sudden this huge game says, you are going to cast it, and you are going to direct this thing. You know, motion capture and voiceover, and it's like, it's on you, so you buckle up, and you just get to it, and I love that responsibility. I just love every minute of it, you know?
I have a question. Yes. What is a motion capture audition? Do people audition for that?
That's a great question.
There are a couple places in Dallas that do motion capture, but I direct like 35, 40 hours a week.
Yeah.
So the voice acting and stuff that I get to do nowadays is mostly based on my reputation and people going, hey, we want you to be in this thing. And then I audition for games out in LA that are looking for non-union folks.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, what is motion capture all about?
It's the trip. Motion capture is, the only problem with motion capture as an actor is that once you do it, you will never want to do anything else.
Yeah.
Mm.
Because I call it the most natural performance an actor will ever have in the most unnatural environment. Because it's this big white room, and you got a microphone here, a camera here, and you're all tight and everything showing that what you got, and it's just, you know, it's pretty intense. And people come out there, celebrities sometimes, right? They're just like, I'm not sure what's going on here. I'm wearing a leotard, you know, and that's kind of, it's a little funky for people at first. But the thing with motion capture is really, you can't get a motion capture gig unless you know the casting director, because nobody's looking for motion capture actors. You know, there are stunt people. There's stunt people. You know what I mean? That's a different thing. But you have to know the actor. And people have asked me to, because I do a lot of voiceover workshops and acting workshops in Los Angeles, and they say we should do a motion capture one. I said, well, I would just be stealing your money. I said, are you an actor? You're a voiceover. You're a motion capture actor. There's a short, you know, learning curve when you're on. It's like, okay, you got to do a few different things. Go online, look at some things. Look at what they're doing online from, you know, all the way back at Avatar. There's plenty of stuff behind the scenes. There'll be a few things, you know, how do you hold a gun? But that doesn't have anything to do with motion capture acting. You know, it's just how do you hold
a gun?
How do you do this? How do you walk through that? But with motion capture, the great thing is that you don't have to cheat for light. You don't have to cheat for a camera. You don't have to cheat to an audience. You're looking right in the other actor's eyes, and it's a real performance. And every bit of your performance is being captured 360 degrees. I directed Knack 1 and 2, and those were all motion capture, and that's it was the first game released on PlayStation 4, and then we did the sequel that came out a few months ago. The creative director on that, we had a lot of boarding done. So the boards were done, so we knew the block. You know, we really had a lot of setup and blocking ahead of time. Sometimes it's not as specific. You might have an area, and then because I'm a live action director, I get to really work with them and find the moments, and then we choose camera angles later. You do your cinematography later because everything's captured. So it's a really beautiful. It's so exciting watching motion capture because it's like live action. And when I cast motion capture, the way I do it, Sometimes I know people have cast motion capture where they do it live, they bring people in and doing the thing, but it's still animation, so I don't do it that way. I do a whole pass of voiceover first, and sometimes they're size specific, because it's so expensive to do different size characters in a game. For motion capture, they have to create different rigs. But some games they don't have as much money, so they'll have the same size, so size isn't an issue. So when I'm casting, I try to do a first pass of voiceover, because it's still a game, and later on they're going to have to do voiceover, not just the motion capture. So you still need things to cut through, you still need to hear the performance. Mm-hmm. So I'll do a huge pass there, and then I'll send all my selects of the people I want, you know, cross-reference them with their IMDb, what have they done before, are they used to being on set, and you know, I do a whole matrix of this before I send it to the client, and all my top picks and sounds and who would sound good with this person, you know, like dozens of characters. So then when they come out on set, when we're gonna do callbacks, everybody sounds exactly the way they want it to sound. It's not like somebody comes out and they're like a good on camera actor, but all of a sudden they sound like this on, you know, voiceover, and they don't just sound right. So everybody that's gonna come on set for the callbacks, they're just gonna kill it. And then you have a problem of choosing, because it's like, these two are just great, and how do you pair it with it? Who do we pair it with? So then once you book that promotion, you know, when you do that audition, see how they can walk and talk and move and really emote, because it's facial too, so you need to see them emote, you need to see that happen, not just voice. So I like to do it in two parts.
That's voice actor and the motion capture, how often are they the same person?
I've never done it any way other than the same, but I know there's sometimes, and it's usually because it's a financial situation where they'll record all the voices first, and then the people on set will act to the motion capture, or they'll do something in the motion capture in Japan, and then they'll set it and they'll do ADR in Los Angeles. So that gets tricky too, because maybe Japanese is a little shorter or longer, or the person moves a little differently, and there's a certain style to, you know, Japanese movement, and then, how things are done here. So then it gets tricky, like with Zelda very specifically, we basically did localization, you know, and the certain anime and animation or games, there's a little soft in the mouth movement, so you have a little leeway. With Zelda, because it was going to be such a big deal, the lips were absolutely perfectly motion captured in Japanese. So the writers and the translators have to create not just a translation that makes sense, but then they have to find the words that are going to fit with all those lip movements, and then now you're asking the actor to go make something cool that make those words fit in that mouth and that performance that was already done. So it gets
welcome to my life.
Yeah. So I mean, a lot of games, Final Fantasy does it, but with Zelda specifically, the lips were so perfect that it had to be just right, because other games I've worked on, they're big games, but it's a little softer and you have a little leeway with things, you know what I mean? Zelda was intense.
It's weird having to do things like that as the director, because in the anime, there's a writer that adapts the script, but really it's the director's prerogative to change anything. Yeah. Anything. The writer's not there. I gotta make it look good in the mouth, and this actor speaks more quickly than the writer imagined, or the writer isn't paying attention to mouth shape, just mouth stop and start. Yeah.
And that's where you're talking about getting the usual suspects, because when you have somebody that knows ADR fairly well,
they know how to, like, oh, I'm going to hang on this vowel right here to make this big mouth thing work, but
otherwise you're doing language, you know, you're helping them with language constantly.
It's so weird, though, how creative you can get to make things match mouth shape, like oohs, ahs, and ohs. I directed a show called Love Live! Sunshine, and I had also been the adaptive writer for the first Love Live! Show, which we did out at Bang Zoom. And I wrote it, and then I was in it. And I didn't live there. They just asked me to do it. They're like, hey, you wrote for us. Somebody told us you'd be a good writer. Would you write this show? I'm like, okay. So I did it. And like, oh, by the way, audition. By the way, you're in it. I'm like, rad. And then a second show came along, but my studio picked it up. And I'm like, hi, I'm your expert in the building. Thank you. So I got it, but it's a slice of life show with all this music and stuff, but when it comes down to mouth shape, it's one of the more specific anime that I've ever seen.
Because usually it's a little softer, you have a little leeway.
Yeah, it's just kind of like, I heard a Japanese animator tell me there are about 6 different mouth shapes, but for general anime shows, they'll only use 3.
Yeah.
And like, just to make it easier and faster. But I guess with Love Live, it's so beautiful, all the animation, that they want the shapes because it adds more.
Yeah.
It makes them more alive.
Yeah,
I thought, well, if they took that much care to draw it that way, I need to spend as much care to make sure our words match those mouths, because it takes you as the audience member right out of it.
Right out of it.
But yeah, you come up with the weirdest things to make it work.
Yeah.
How can I just move these words around, or what word it does that double flaps and then an ooh?
Yeah.
You're sitting here just like thinking of English stuff, and I don't know how we can make it work.
Yeah, it works somehow. And then you know you rely on your brilliant actors. You're just like, oh, thank you.
Yeah.
For getting it.
Any ideas?
Yeah. Like Final Fantasy, specifically Mobius, that I've been doing for about 3.5 years, is a downloadable one. And if you haven't played it, it's really cool. It's like, I mean, it's going to be recording for another 3 years on that too, because it's episodic. It comes out. But that it's just a timing thing. You do an ADR, but we just have a time. You can't go more than 5 frames under, and more than like 5 frames over the timing. So you're asking. I mean, it gets pretty tricky for an actor, because it's like a little shorter, a little longer, a little shorter, a little longer, a little shorter, a little longer. So ADR is it could be a really tricky world. But in gaming, there's a lot of that.
That answer your question?
Yeah.
You just gotta give us a little bit, and we'll take it and run with it.
I got a question. When dealing with technical shows, like initially a car show, and you're changing the words around for the dub, do you have somebody on staff that lets you know, like, oh yeah, it still makes sense, or if you change that word around, it just kind of sounds off?
Well, I'm only doing dubs in English. So I'm just doing it in English. So I know what it's good. I know the right way. Sometimes they rely on me to do changes, and I've been hired many times to go through a script and make it more conversational. So that doesn't happen with me. You know what I mean? But sometimes, you know, with Japanese, they'll use Japanese translation, and somebody will be there. I always have like a client there for specifically some of the things. Just in case, maybe even they wrote it, there might be a moment where they're going, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense now with the line before. So there might be some changes on the fly.
Okay.
Because I'll even see it in English, you know, because a lot of times scripts, even the big games, I won't get the scripts till that day, but I've been doing it for years, so I'm able to kind of interpret things pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll see something that doesn't make sense and doesn't jive with something later. But I don't, that's about as far as it goes for me.
Yeah, I mean, the writers in shows that have something very specific about them, be it military knowledge and history and knowing things, we have resources at Funimation. Like, here are military ranking systems throughout the world, you know, the highest to lowest in the Navy and the Marines and the whatever, even though we're dealing with some fantasy anime world, right? So we have access to that kind of stuff. But the head of all the writers tries to assign shows to adaptive writers that are skilled in particular areas. Like, I know the guy who usually does the military-based shows because he's a huge history buff and war buff. So those shows go to him, and it's part of the writer's job. But we get a lot of information from our translators. I've seen the in-house translations at Funimation have very detailed notes when there is interesting stuff about the wordplay, or here's what the Japanese are going for, just to let the writer know this isn't going to hit if you do it exactly the Japanese way, because it's a word joke, and you know, so use some other word joke but in English, those kind of things. So by the time it gets to the director, the only time we need to move stuff around, it's usually based on timing. If there's a writer who is just not understanding the context or what a scene is supposed to be, they won't be writing for us for very long. Fingers crossed. Fingers crossed. But yeah.
Sure. When you're casting or making creative decisions, do fans ever influence your choice? Because there's online petitions of voice actors they prefer. There's like all these big, loud people with like loud opinions, and they kind of have a mob mentality sometimes. Does that ever affect your choices?
Even though you're the director, you might even be a writer on it, you might even be the casting director, we're not making the final decisions. It's the client is making the final decisions, and they're doing the right thing, because they're looking at their fan base. I mean, who's the game's for? It's for the fans. So if there's something where they don't want this lead replaced, or they don't want this one character replaced,
interesting.
You know, there is that thing where people get online, and you know, the actor, of course, like, thank you for Twitter, you know, thank you for online petitions. But we don't have that kind of influence. I mean, they will always. always ask me, like, I always put my top selects, and they really respect what I want to do, you know, they always do, and most of the time they do pick them. But if there's, the only time it would ever be like that, where it's a petition or something like that, would be as if you're trying to replace a character with somebody else, then the client will, you know, look at their HR department and talk to everybody and go, should we do this? Is this, are people going to be fired if we change this? Mm-hmm. But that's really my experience, that's the only time that happens.
Yeah, and with anime, it's Funimation gets the majority of shows for the dubbing. They're the market share leader in the country. And there's a handful of shows that end up in Los Angeles, and usually the Aniplex shows, because their Aniplex USA is based out there. And traditionally, or historically, I find that Japanese clients that want to be more involved in the casting and the overall top to bottom of their show, how it's going to turn out, they'll seek to go to LA. Whereas clients that trust the name of Funimation and just trust us to do a good job and get it done, they come to us. Does that mean that one or the other is better? No, it takes a lot longer to do it in Los Angeles because you've got non-English speakers in the room with you as an actor trying to tell you how your performance is not conveying. It's like they forget that it's for an English-speaking audience. I'm going to get off that soapbox. But anyway.
it all depends, like, in the game, you know what I mean?
Yeah, the game world is different. Yeah, the game is a different situation.
There's so much money
involved. I've had good experiences with games coming from Japan and being at, like, with Street Fighter. By the time we got around to Street Fighter V, they really trusted the actors that were in it because they'd cast us for Street Fighter 4, and we'd done about 3 or 4 iterations of that game by the time 5 rolled around. So by 5, they were Skyping in just because they wanted to be in the room because it was so fun. Mm-hmm. And it was really cool for me to know that on the other side of the glass is the director that I'm used to, plus a Capcom rep, and then like 5 different people like are in Japan right now in their pajamas, like drinking tea, listening to me shout stuff as Cammy, and telling me that even in Japan they switch over to my voice. I'm like, are you kidding? Cool. All that. Wow, I went in a huge circle. For anime, their fans have a lot of input, but I also find that they don't always understand the boundaries and the guidelines of union, non-union, where actors actually live, and if it's possible. And they assume that because now Source Connect is a thing that more studios have, that means like Jamie's in LA and I want him in my show, he can go to a studio with a particular setup and he can be there recording and I can hear him in Dallas and he can be in my thing. But just because that's available doesn't mean I can get everybody that I want from LA to come be in my little C title anime, right? So fans online petitioning would be like asking for like impossible things.
For gaming, it's just usually it's what I'm saying, like if there's a problem or something. But when you talk about clients coming in, like Japanese clients are different from different countries, clients in Denmark, all over the world, and usually if I have like a more than one or two people in the room, sometimes it's a game I just worked on for months, there was 12 people in the room at all times. But what I do is, you know, they trust me so much, and then as long as I have one person I go to and say, you have to be the point person if you need to, you know, and everybody usually is very cool. It's not usually a process of a committee. It's usually like if there's a problem, if this person can't answer it, people are there to get it from it. It's heavy dialogue stuff. If it's stuff where it's a lot of call outs and short lines and stuff like that, there's usually sometimes I don't even have a client. They just trust me. They just go, you're directing the game. There's nobody there, and that's great. But when there's a lot of heavy dialogue back and forth and character arcs and story arcs, I have to have those people there because I might go in a different direction or something. And you make changes on the fly sometimes, the story.
That's really nice, actually. I mean, here, a second ago, I was like, man, it would stink to have the Japanese around all the time. But one thing we're dealing with the simuldub situation is sometimes as the show is airing, we as directors don't know where the show is going because there isn't any source material. And we struggle with not having the information up front from the Japanese clients because maybe it's a secret and they just won't send it to us. It would all
context.
Be it would all be in Japanese and it would need to get translated, but there's all kinds of stuff. Like this character that looks like a boy but sounds like a girl. Episode 12, is it actually going to end up being a girl or a boy? That kind of matters for, you know, casting from episode 1, or who is this secret character, or who really is the killer? So I do wish that I just had a client. I could be like, hey, what who is this?
Yeah.
It is not that easy.
Well, I have another question for the anime casting part.
Sure.
So for that, I know some animes go without the manga ever finishing.
Mm.
Does that really influence the casting or any kind of work that you do with the anime if the manga isn't done?
No, not really. I think directors will use a manga to know what characters might appear. Like I said, with simuldubs, if, you know, I got to start directing it, I've only seen one episode, but there's this manga that is at least 3 volumes in, so I know where it's going to be maybe a few weeks from now. But I don't think that it would... A lot of the time, it depends on what the anime does. Some anime are made just to be 12 episodes, and others are open-ended, and there's more manga. And in the future, if this was successful, maybe they'll make more later. But no, it doesn't really affect that.
Okay, I have a question.
Yeah.
I'm going to compare this between anime, AAA games, and indie games. How much does it cost for voice acting, like to hire a voice actor to voice in an anime or a AAA game or an indie game?
Well, I can't speak for anime, but I can speak for games. You know, some games are non-union and some are union. When they're union game, there are there's rates. So usually they have to be paid at least the scale rate for whatever, under whatever contract it is. And it's usually the SAG Interactive contract. And I think it's, for voice actor, I think it's like $8.45, somewhere around that, plus 10% for the agent for a 4-hour session in games. And if it's non-union, it's generally, it could be a guarantee of $400 for at least 2 hours and $200 an hour after that. But usually try never to go more than 4 hours. But I know some people have, and there's some emergency situations where because after 4 hours, it becomes diminishing returns, you know, with somebody's voice and performance, unless it's an emergency. But that's about the rate. But if an actor is, you know, more sought after, then they might get more. They might get more than scale. But a lot of time, you know, specifically for the lead characters or something like that, they might get more than scale. But usually a lot of games are scale. And, hello? Oh, you're so nice. You're so thirsty. But, so that's usually about that. Unless you have celebrities, negotiations with celebrities and stuff like that. But usually a lot of games are scale or double scale or something like that. It starts at like 8:45, somewhere around there.
And for indie games, it depends on how indie we're talking.
Yeah.
You know, like there are a lot of games nowadays that are crowdfunded.
It's like $100.
Yeah, like especially ones that are coming from Japan. Like it could have been a light novel type, a visual novel type game for the PS Vita or something like that. Stuff that the Japanese company would like to get it localized, but even they can't afford it. So fans contributing is kind of like a sign of good faith that people do want this game and will buy it. But that kind of stuff, I've gotten some auditions come across my way for things like that. Or maybe it's a game that's just going to be available on Steam.
You get a bowl of soup if you're good.
Yeah, you're paid like by the line. And but usually they're really good about letting you know the character breakdown.
Yeah.
Like, here are these 25 characters. These top 4 are going to have 4 hours of work. But this person down at the bottom is like 3 sentences. And you're going to get paid like $15. And you record it from your house. You know, like, but these are a lot, that's the way that up-and-coming voice actors start to build their resume, however. Because someone who is always in the studio doing any kind of recording, commercial stuff, driving across town from this studio to that studio, it's not that they, like, well, I don't know, like, throw their nose up at those kind of auditions, but they don't have time for those kinds of auditions.
So they're trying to make money.
They're driving across town. They don't have the time, because even those auditions for those games where you're going to make $15, you still have to do a good job and record it and edit it and blah, blah, blah.
But generally stuff like that I do in LA, if it's a non-union gig, I'm not going to cast it unless there's a certain rate, because I'm not going to insult my actors. You know what I mean? They trust me. You know, it takes years to build the trust over, you know, more than a decade of doing this stuff. So I won't do stuff that's in that world, because I'm not going to ask the actors to do it. So it's usually a guarantee of $400 for the 2 hours, and then you know, unless it's union.
Anime, because that was the other part of his question, so how does anime pay? Anime, no, regardless of how much you consume it or what it seems like to you if you watch English first, it's still technically just ADR. It's automated dialogue replacement, additional dialogue replacement. You're another audio track. So I think the union rate for that is like 75,
yeah, it's
75 an hour. Texas, where I live, is a right-to-work state, so that means you don't have to be in a union to get the work. So everything at Funimation is non-union. And there's also kind of a scale for veteran actors versus brand new actors. So
you guys almost created your own system, your own sort of union within Funimation.
Yeah, and even that's quite recent. I don't even know if I'm supposed to be talking about it, but the veterans who've been around a long time and have shown, especially since the simuldub started up, you can track how consistently they are cast and that kind of thing, how many hours they've put in over the last handful of years. They're making what is union rate for ADR. But it is just by the hour. There's no hourly guarantee. Though folks with agents can have what's called a minimum through their agency. So maybe your character has two sentences this week, but your agent has a 3-hour minimum for you. You know, so he's going to make $225 for three sentences. So not so bad when you think of it that way.
And when it's a union game, especially at the end of a game, when you're doing pickups and stuff, there might be something quick emergency. An actor might come in for like literally one sentence and get $845 for like 3 minutes of work. So that's a nice day. You know, that's a good day.
It's really encouraging to hear that directors are out looking for new talent, for people who are interested in entering the game.
I get cards from people here.
Yeah.
I meet people in restaurants and I just hear a voice or they're talking to an actor and I say, well, let me send me stuff. If you don't send it to me, I won't know you.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, and that's so super encouraging. But outside of meeting you at a tiki bar, everyone's saying you're working with agencies, you're working with people who know people.
I do workshops. I do a lot of workshops in town, and you know, there's where I bring people in, and so I have a lot of that stuff's for non-union. But then those people I also bring in if they're FICOR, so they can work union and non-union. Then I'll bring them in for union stuff too. But that's how I discover people. It's because the market that I'm in Los Angeles, that's where I cast. You know what I mean? And a lot of the projects, they don't want to use people outside of living outside of LA. I mean, there's times we do that in New York and stuff like that, but it's always a pain in the ass. It's not.
Because you gotta get a pickup later on.
They're not there, and then you have to get, and plus you have to have another studio. You know, it's like, well, you can do it at home, not for these big games. They don't want you to record at home. They want you to be in a studio, so then they're paying double for that 4 hours, so they don't want to do it. If you're in LA, you're in LA. They want you to do that, but to just get discovered, to get on people's radar.
Yeah.
I don't know what the community is down here for voiceover, if there is one at all. I don't. I really
a little bit, but
a little
not,
bit.
Certainly not what it is in LA.
Yeah, yeah, and I'm sure Dallas, too.
It's funny though, because I'm Dallas. Funimation has been in DFW for 20 some odd years, but there's still plenty of local actors that really want to get in there and don't know how. Because as I mentioned to the first young lady who had questions, we don't have auditions that often. And for the longest time, when we would have them, we would get a lot of folks from the open call list that, to be honest, room full of fans, are fans. And they want to be in anime because they love anime, but not because they're necessarily actors. So we've struggled, and we're like, do we have to do open auditions? It's a lot of work to maybe get two actors out of a week's worth of people.
Especially when it's non-union, it's not, you're a different market,
Yeah.
But is your question leaning towards, how do I get in?
I mean, essentially, yeah, but also, if we join an agency down here, how do we know that agency is going to be one that's going to be worth our time? I mean, you're paying an agent. So.
It's who's on their roster, on their roster, what have they done and stuff like that, having a good, getting your good reel together. And I always suggest to people is if you really want to do this stuff and you're, maybe there's the foreshadowing of going to LA or going to Dallas or New York or something like that, is really get a, if you're thinking about games or even commercial, whatever it is, get a workout group together so you guys are bouncing ideas off each other constantly. Make sure it's every Tuesday or every Wednesday you get your group of people that are, and if they don't start showing up, they're out, get the next person in, and really work at that so hard, because then you have contacts out there, so-and-so's doing this and so-and-so's doing, now they're recording in this studio, and so-and-so's with that agent. You just got a network, and it might be a smaller voiceover market down here. I imagine it's a lot of advertising.
That's really what
I imagine.
Commercials, phone messages, yeah. It's really big.
Yeah. Because I'm from Chicago and I was a producer there, so we recorded 90% of my commercial voiceover talent lived in Chicago, and so we recorded there. So that's a big community for commercial. So it all depends what you want to pursue, because if you want to pursue something like games, not that you're saying that, but it's hard to be here and pursue games. But if you want to pursue advertising, you might get a niche and you might be the guy. You might be their guy here.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
All right.
And you can pursue other agents. You get a good reel. You can pursue an agent in Denver. Pursue an agent in Utah. You get your reel out there.
Okay.
And you just never know. And Voices 123 is a great place to put your reel on and do a lot of auditions for. But you could have agents all over the country. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Of course.
Hope it helped.
Yeah. Any other questions?
What else you guys got?
Yeah.
Got,
oh my God.
About 12 more minutes.
Yeah.
I have another question.
Sure, buddy.
Sure.
Yeah, since, so please excuse if my sentence isn't clear, but I am studying for, my major is computer science in my college, but I did took a class called Cinema Appreciation, and one thing I studied about there is that the director has its own script. So for anime, does the ADR director has its own script?
My script is the same script that the actor is using, like literally. I have two screens in front of me, and my script screen is here, and it's connected to the actor's script screen in the booth. So there's no paper or anything in there that could like get rustled around for them to write on, which sometimes might be frustrating, but any changes that I need to make happen in real time. A lot of the time, the actor also can't see me terribly well, like there's a glare on the glass. So I indicate with my cursor a lot on the script and highlight what we're working on. I can make lines, words bigger, bolder, smaller, just to help them with hints of what I need them to do for all that crazy mouth shape stuff that we talked about at the beginning of the panel. So it's not like my script is somehow different from another person's, right? There's the translation, and the translation document then goes to a script ADR prep person. They prepare the translation for writing by adding all of the efforts and excerpts and fight sounds and things that are not words. That's all put in by ADR prep, along with the time code, which is a marking for hours, minutes, seconds, and frames when sounds are heard or when mouths are seen moving. Okay, this is a poor person's job. Oh my gosh, it's so tedious. So once all that is done, and they also add time code to the translation, so the writer knows that line in Japanese means that thing in English, and now I can put it into this box for the actor and add where all of the pauses and all of the punctuation goes. And then when that's done, that's what I get.
And for games, it's ditto.
Yeah.
Now, for games, it's the same kind of thing. We have the same script. You know, I mean, I'll have, like, many, many conversations with clients, especially when it's heavy dialogue stuff ahead of time. So, you know, and usually, like, right before the session, or sometimes if it's for specifically motion capture, I'll have many discussions, just like treat it like a film. I'll have many discussions about where the moments are, where the arcs of the character, where the arcs of the story is, and the arc in this scene. And we'll have a lot of discussion like that. So my script will be, you know, paper script will be noted up. I'll have all my notes, how I want to talk to the actors about it. The actors generally have the same script.
Yeah, game scripts are so involved, though. They're like, they're spreadsheets with multiple sheets, and you think you're done. They're like, okay, now let's go to the battle dialogue, and that whole thing disappears. An entire new document is open. Well, oh, man.
It's intense. And it all depends on the studio, too. So some of the studios have, like, the screen. We look at the screen. Some are still paper. Because it depends on the game, too, because sometimes it's just, sometimes it's not going to help the talent to have that on the screen. Sometimes they need to take notes because things are changing so fast.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
So, but,
good question.
Yes.
That was cool.
Yes.
That was cool.
Mm-hmm. When it comes to the video games and you're working on, I guess, the like story and the characters, how involved are you in the way the game plays?
The gameplay, actual gameplay?
Yeah.
Not really involved in that, but they rely on you to tell the to help tell the story, and you're part of the system. You don't want to. There's a couple games I won't say, but there's things where something started ahead of time, and I got involved, and I said I really want to change this style. You know, it's really more about the performances, and then sometimes those performances could influence gameplay, because now this character is just a little more like this, and maybe this guy is a little different. Maybe his attention is different. Maybe his manner is different, so they might change the gameplay. But as far as like how the game mechanics work specifically, or how the story or happens. No, you're not gonna have, you don't have influence that. They'll trust you. They might ask you questions or something, but that's their thing. They're developing the game. I don't make games. You know, I'm a performance director. Performances that I write, so they don't ask me that stuff. I'm like, just do it. Meat puppet.
What's your favorite anime or video game that you love directing the most?
Oh man.
Careful, so everyone.
I know.
But is it the right one?
It's tricky. It's kind of a tie now, I think. Everyone expects me to say Ouran High School Host Club, but that's kind of like my favorite, like, I don't want to say old school. It is a 10-year-old show. It's kind of from a different time in my life. So I directed, then I got married, and I moved to another country and lived there for a time and came back. And then it was, so there's about 5 years where I wasn't directing. So Ouran's like my favorite from the first bout of directing. And more recently, I direct a franchise called Garo. And it has 3 anime shows. The first is called Garo the Animation, the second, Garo Crimson Moon, and the third I'm working on right now called Garo Vanishing Line. And I don't know what it is about it, but I really, really like it. The middle show I didn't really like that much. I knew that it wasn't as good as the previous show, but they do something really neat with their casting. It's these series are unrelated. They follow the same kind of legendary hero of Garo. He's a big golden knight guy who comes and saves the day and fights evil and whatever. But like the Garo the Animation is set in a fictional Spain-like country, pre-Spanish Inquisition. The middle show is set in like Heian-era Japan, so that's anywhere between 700 and 1100 AD in Japan. And the current one is like a post-modern American story. The characters are never the same, save one guy, this talking ring that belongs to the Garo Knight, wherever the heck, whatever country he's in, whatever. But in Japan, they use the same cast of voice actors. And maybe the guy who was Garo in this show, the Golden Knight, and the next show, he's the Silver Knight, and he's a little bit shady now. He's not necessarily the good guy. And by Garo Vanishing Line, that same voice actor is now playing the villain. And the guy who was the villain in the middle show is now the hero in the current show. So this is like my third Garo show in two years. So it's, oh man, it's good. And they're all a little bit longer. A lot of anime nowadays are only 12 episodes. And each of these Garo things are 25 episodes long. I'm really enjoying it. It just kind of spices it up. ADR directing can get to be like the same thing every day, especially you get 12 episode show, it's over, here's your next 12 episode show. But it's kind of, I dig it. Check out some Garo, do yourself a favor.
Yeah, I will. That sounds cool.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
Yeah.
Where's that airing?
So Vanishing Line, you can watch it in Japanese on Crunchyroll. In fact, the second core, they do seasons in cores nowadays, they call them. Just started today, so we'll start recording on it on Monday. So Funimation Streaming has all the Garo shows. Yeah. Sorry that it's not on TV, though it's tailor-made for it. So yeah. I keep my fingers crossed that somebody will figure it out and be like, that thing's cool, put it on television. Because that's how it works.
Yeah. Yeah. You hope, you know.
Yeah.
Well, for me, it's like, you know, because I've been doing that a long time, games, and for me, it's like, it's almost like the most current game is my favorite game that I've worked on. You know, I'm coming off of Zelda, was just amazing. But then Horizon Zero Dawn, you know, kind of happening at the same time. So it was two different, completely different styles. But it was each one of those were so amazing to work on. But I do love the Hitman series. I've been doing that for years because I get to do a lot of improvising and a lot of writing. So that really gets me going because I can just put my, you know, there's a lot of darkness in Hitman, a lot of lightness in Zelda. You know what I mean? So I love both worlds. I could find creativity and, you know, satisfaction in both worlds. And then Final Fantasy, I've been doing that for years and years, and just love that world. That I mean, it's just so entertaining working on that kind of stuff, and having done the feature at Kingsglaive also, that was, you know, a little different than of course a game, but most of the time, it's like my favorite stuff is the stuff that I'm currently working on, because that's the newest thing. But I have such fond memories of stuff like way back, like Bulletstorm. Something, I don't know if anybody knows Bulletstorm. But I mean, it's ridiculous. It's so so fun and over the top. And I did Let It Die also, and that, I don't know if anybody knows Let It Die, it's Suda 51. You know, I mean, oh my God, it's just they let me go off on that. They said, you cast whoever you want. They gave me a budget, and I was able to cast celebrities. I brought Mark Hamill in, I brought Billy Dee Williams, who was Landau, of course.
So cool.
And then was able to bring in, because it was a horror game, and they brought in both Sumaras from Ring 1 and Ring 2, and then Mark Ralston from Aliens, and then Stephen Bauer from Scarface, and they said, we want a really eclectic cast.
Wow.
I'm like, all right, I can do this. You know, I have really good relationships with all the agents in town, so even though it wasn't a big budget for everybody, they were letting me, the agents knew me, and they said, you're going to have fun, this will be a good game. So something like that, to me, is just so entertaining, because they just let me go off on casting and just do whatever I wanted to do. But then, you know, come again back to Zelda, which is very specific and you know, fantasy style. So it's like, whatever I'm working on at the time is my favorite thing. Did I go in a circle? Did that answer the question?
Cool.
But, anybody have questions? Anything?
2 whole minutes.
I could juggle.
Really?
Like,
me too.
Boiler.
Yeah, same.
Well, now I want to see it.
Maybe I can juggle.
I'll give you a question.
Sure.
Okay, so I was in the Overwatch Q&A panel in the afternoon, and one thing I did heard from them on how they got their voice acting roles in Overwatch is that there's auditions. Is that the same thing with video games?
It is. That's what I do. That's all I do is video games, and that's, you have to audition for your game. You know, you have to audition for it, and you know, especially for a big game. You know, there are some games, like I said, like Let It Die was a very specific situation where they know my reputation. They were just like, you know, whoever you think this is, you bring him in. And then there was 14 player characters, and I brought, you know, all the people that I know that could scream and die and do all the killer things. And, you know, I don't have to cast that. I know exactly who can do those things, and, you know, male and female. But most of the time, 99% of the time, you're having it cast, because there's so much money involved in these games. They're so huge, and they're more expensive than feature films, you know, many times over. So people want to hear stuff. You know, they're going to take your advice, but they want to hear stuff.
All right, guys. Well, this has been fun.
Yeah.
Thanks for your
thank
cool
you.
Questions.
Thank you.
Hey, wasn't that fun? I know I had a great time. If you want to see some more great videos just like that, you can click right over here. Also, click here to subscribe to our channel and leave a thumbs up and a comment in the section below. Thank you so much for watching, guys. We'll see you next time.